Imagine you need to run an application on a fleet of servers. Let me show you something. We got a VMware here, that's VM1, and another one, VM1, and VM2, and then VM3. Looking at this, I need to deploy an application on each server. What you're gonna do? You're gonna simply go login in each and every one. That's a login. Okay, and then you deploy your application. Even though it's the same application, you still have to go through the process. So after you logged in and everything and you stole the application, let's say you got a problem, you're gonna have to go log in again, troubleshoot, and good luck with that. So normally, this is a very manual process. With workload orchestrators, if something went and happened wrong, you don't have to go all of this because it really automates that and eliminates all the human intervention and automate all of this.
So you describe what you want the application to do, right? You say, these are the resources it requires. This is the runtime requirements. And the orchestrator is going to place it on its own, right? It's going to handle deployment. It's going to handle scaling. It's going to handle resiliency all automatically. Ray, tell me, what is workload orchestration?
Great question. So workload orchestrator is a process that allows organizations to run multiple apps, like web apps, for example. And we got also AI and ML workflows, also job batches, let's say. All of this, you can run it on multiple servers and environments. And that's kind of simplified way of automation, which they're common and the workflow like also automates the scheduling, automates the placement and the health monitoring as well. As that being said, workload orchestrator, it just takes the whole manual process that I was talking about earlier and automates it for you and doesn't worry. You don't have to worry about if anything fails.
So can you give me an example?
Yeah. So for example, if let's say we have a server here and this server failed, the workload orchestrator, I would say WO, will automatically check a job and bring it back to the same state. Did David get interview here? No. Did Ray touch it? No. We didn't have to log in, didn't have to do anything. So actually, this whole manual process was eliminated, and the workload orchestrator by itself was able to treat the failure not as a crisis as before we used to. Now it's treating it as a business as usual.
We use Kubernetes, the two of us, right?
Yeah.
Many companies use Kubernetes. We love Kubernetes. Why would we use this approach?
Great question. Kubernetes is an amazing tool. There's no doubt about it. But let's think about it. If you have a deployment, let's say this is the deployment, okay? Does deployment come by itself? No. It comes with a lot of components. You can talk like, we can say CM, config map. We can say a secret. We can say storage. How many YAMLs here we're talking about? We're talking about 4 configured YAMLs, right? Let's see. So on the other side, if we're talking about workload orchestrator, we got the DevOps guy. He just does something simple. He just pushes one single HCL job. Where it goes? It goes to your workload orchestrator, and it reads that job, finds out how many replicas you want, and then deploys your application. Assuming you got 3 replicas, you got 3 applications. And also respecting your strategy. You got a deployment strategy here. And also all of this just runs on a single server. You got an operating system down there. Whereas the orchestrating living on the top, all of this is inside your VM.
So I see YAMLs. We know YAMLs. We've written YAMLs for Kubernetes. What is a job, and is there a hard learning curve to learn it?
I don't think so. There's a hard learning curve. You have a single file, and it's a very lightweight. The best case scenarios, the DevOps will deploy a traditional application. It will take him days, not months. So in this case, as he goes, he has another feature, so he starts to learn about it. And has another feature, and has another start to learn about it. So it's not about the application itself, is about your own pace. So you can go by your own speed. You want to go and learn the whole thing quick? Sure, you can do that. If you want to go, take it easy and so go as you go. And that's what I recommend. Yeah. Workload orchestrator sounds useful for traditional application deployments. What about AI and ML? Do they can be blended in the whole thing here?
So what is the traditional approach for AI, right? Some companies, they're going to spin up a Kubernetes cluster for their web apps, another one for their training, and a third for their batch, right? Mm-hmm. Some other companies are just going to put it all on one cluster with all that entails, right? Complex namespace configurations, you have resource quotas. Now, whichever way you go with this, mm-hmm. you're going to end up with a headache, right? If you have multiple clusters, you have multiple ops teams, multiple monitoring teams. If you have one cluster that's supposed to be for everybody, it's going to be difficult to deal with. And on top of all of this, AI workloads keep evolving, right? You had 8 years ago, we didn't have transformer models. 3 years ago, we didn't have GPT-level inferencing. Now, if you've worked with AI or ML workloads before, you may have noticed a pattern. So for your web teams, they're going to be deploying microservices on Kubernetes. Mm-hmm. Your data scientists, they might be using Slurm. Because that's what they use in grad school, right? And that's how they work with GPU jobs. Your data engineers, they're going to work with Airflow as their pipeline management. And then the ML team, they might be deploying services, you know, in containers, or maybe they're just SSHing directly into a box and running custom scripts. That's four teams with four tool sets and four totally different sets of expertise. If something breaks, well, good luck figuring out which system is the problem.
Okay, so this is awesome. Walk me through a real world example.
Okay. So if you have a data scientist that wants to run a training job, mm-hmm. they're first going to file a ticket with their DevOps.
Yeah.
They're going to wait for the cluster to be ready. They're going to wait for the approval. Mm-hmm. And a couple of days later, they're able to train their model.
Exactly.
At the same exact time, the web team has deployed continuously on Kubernetes. So this is the same company, the same organization, and just got a totally different universe of efficiency. AI workloads are fundamentally different. A training job could run for 3 hours and never run again. Your inferencing service has to be on 24/7. It's connected to your GPU and your pipeline runs on a schedule. This needs something like flexible orchestration. Mm-hmm. And especially considering we do not know what's coming next, but we do know it's coming, it has to stay flexible.
Awesome. So hold on. Flexible sounds interesting. Tell me more about it.
First, a caveat, right? Yeah. Why can't we do this on Kubernetes?
Mm-hmm.
We can do this on Kubernetes, right? We could run batch jobs. We have cron jobs. All this stuff works. But if you've ever tried to run ephemeral services like, you know, batch workload on Kubernetes, it's a bit awkward.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because Kubernetes wasn't designed for this. It was designed for long-running containerized services that it keeps alive. Now, workload orchestrators, they're a bit different, right? If you have a batch job or you have a system job or you have a service that you need running, they're all first-class citizens in the scheduler.
So tell me more about this in the drawing, maybe?
Sure. So like when you think about flexible orchestration, let's get back to that.
Yeah.
Right? You're going to have one cluster.
Sure.
Right? And this is going to be your workload.
Okay.
Orchestrator. And it's going to be able to spin up your web app.
Okay.
It's going to be able to spin up your training and your batches that mm-hmm. run once and then never run again. It's going to have your inferencing. And each of these services are going to be tied to a resource. And each of these resources can be defined within the job spec. So it makes it particularly easy. So you could have a job spec that says, okay, I need this spread out between one data center, or I need this on a combination of data centers, or I need this to be on a specific data center on a specific rack.
Awesome. So what I'm looking at here, I can imagine there is like, correct me if I'm wrong, before and after thing. So if we're looking at before here, And I'll give you a square here saying we got, you said fragmented ops.
Also, we got many tools.
And also there is special knowledge, let me say.
Yeah, when you go to flexible orchestration, instead of all of that,
mm-hmm.
we're going to have unified ops.
Okay.
We're going to have one tool.
Perfect.
And we're going to have shared knowledge. Which makes this so much easier and so much more scalable.
Okay, so what does that really mean for teams, you know?
So if you look back at the data scientists, uh-huh. right? This time, they could schedule their own training, okay. right? They could do it themselves. It takes a couple of minutes, not a couple of days. They're in the same exact workflow as their web app team. Mm-hmm. Your DevOps team, they have one platform that they need to know really well.
Okay.
So if something breaks at 2 a.m., they know where to look. They have one set of logs to look at, and it just works well. So this is the power of flexible orchestration. And when the next AI breakthrough comes, because we know it's coming, you don't rebuild your infrastructure. You write a new job spec. That's operational simplicity without sacrificing capability.